Hey, everybody. Thanks for tuning into Harris Football. I'm Dave Piper. I'm sitting here with Christopher Harris.
Hey, Dave Piper.
Hey. And we're here today to talk about the truth about five controversial players. I know that Chris was writing the Almanac this year, poured over tons of film. And
I did. Lots of film. I mean, so the idea behind this video, basically, Dave, I thought, let me see if I can come up with a list of the five players that I watched the most film on. And I think this probably represents, for the purposes of writing the Almanac, where I was watching, hundreds of hours of film probably over the course of the spring and summer. These are probably the five guys that I watched the most games of, because either they were unexpectedly good and I was trying to figure out what happened, or maybe they were unexpectedly bad and I thought, like, did they turn bad? So anyway, five guys that we definitely, I spent tons of time on the Almanac on these five players.
Yeah, I know that when we wanted to start going through the players that you watched the most, one of the first players that jumped out was Ryan Tannehill to you, because, he's pretty controversial.
Well, and it's a great point, because, like, there probably aren't that many people out there saying Ryan Tannehill should be QB7. What a moron you are. Like, that's not really what's going on. Not a lot of people are drafting Tannehill to be their fantasy starter, except for potentially maybe in a super flex league, but he's the key to making everything else work. And there's a stat that I was tossing out to you guys earlier that I think is right, that from the moment he took the starting job in Tennessee last year, the Titans scored the most points in the NFL. So can't Ryan Tannehill be good enough to keep AJ Brown and Jonnu Smith and Derrick Henry all awesome and fantasy relevant? And so I went back and watched a lot of film. And so he's not a favorite player of mine. I call him dog sausage. He's unbelievably disappointing over many seasons in Miami. Just lots of knuckleheaded mistakes that he didn't make in Tennessee. And I watched that film and looked for mistakes and didn't really see all that many. And I also don't want to say it was pure luck, because he went down the field when he had to a few times here and there. But what stands out most going back to that film is I think the Titans got awfully lucky in the passing game with a lot of short passes to AJ Brown where he just run for 85 yards. And so of course everybody's numbers look great when that happens, right? I mean, the stats are going to lie when you get these sort of unrepeatable big plays in a way that AJ Brown, that's a feature, not a bug. He's a great open field runner, but he's not the greatest open field runner in the history of the position, which is kind of how he played last year.
Absolutely. Yeah. And I mean, one of my favorite nicknames that you have on the show is for Tannehill, because he's dog sausage. It's just great.
Right.
And, we saw a lot of this when he was in Miami, where he had flashes of brilliance, but is it really that reliable?
Sure. I mean, he never did it like he did it last year. So I will admit, there's a lot of good stuff on the film, but I think they're asking him, as I say in the Almanac, it's a line from Chinatown, as little as possible. Like, they're asking him to do as little as possible to win games.
Mm-hmm. All right, we got four more players to get back to our list, but today our sponsor is Thursday Boots.
They are Thursday Boots. How excited are we that we have Thursday Boots as a sponsor? I've got my old pair of Thursday Boots right here. Oh, yeah. They hold out great. Dave Piper, do you have Thursday Boots to show?
Yes, I have my brand new pair right here, and they are awesome. They are awesome.
They are fantastic. Thursday Boots has been a sponsor of the podcast for like 5 years. I'm very familiar with those guys. I've been to their offices. They're incredibly nice guys, which really wouldn't matter if the boots weren't spectacular, which they are. They absolutely look great, but they have incredible durability. My pair is 5 years old, and I still wear them all the time. They're absolutely fantastic. They have a cork bed midsole that conforms to your foot. It's the look of a fashion boot, but the durability of a work boot. I am a huge believer in Thursday Boots. If you're looking for a nice pair of boots for the fall, I mean, ThursdayBoots.com/HarrisFootball. I cannot possibly recommend them enough. And Dave Piper, I know you've tried yours on. You just got yours. We decided to order some for everybody on the show. Comfortable.
Oh, yeah. I can't wait for the fall. Like, when I finally put them on, just the craftsmanship of the way they fit my foot, I was like, oh, man, I cannot wait to wear a nice pair of dark jeans with these beautiful boots. Yeah.
Fantastic. Forever in blue jeans. That would be Dave Piper. But yeah, ThursdayBoots.com/HarrisFootball. We love them.
All right, let's get right back into the list. Last year, David Johnson was more than a disappointment. And, I know that you watched film on him, so let's hear about what you saw.
Yeah, so another one where, kind of for the opposite reason as Tannehill, I'm watching a ton of David Johnson because you want to get a sense of what happened. And I'll say, it would be dumb for me to say there were no big plays on film. They mostly came in the receiving game, but I found plenty of plays where David Johnson, especially early in the year, was you know, catching a short little pass and then knocking guys over, breaking like three or four tackles in a play. There's still something there, but it would be hard to deny that as a running back, he took a big shot on his wrist like week two or something like that. And he had to come out of that game. He had to come out of another game because of injury. It from my way of thinking, you know, he's with Houston now. And rightly is not being drafted probably as a top 20 running back because he comes with a ton of injury risk and because he's been disappointing. I don't think it's totally over. What I have him running back 22 in a standard league, probably, you know, a little bit higher than that in a PPR. And, you know, I will admit, I joke in the Almanac, you know, at times we forget that Alfred Morris for like 5 minutes was on the Arizona roster last year. And then, oh, by the way, no, we don't forget because David Johnson was doing an Alfred Morris tribute act through much of the first half of the year before getting benched for Kenyon Drake. So I can't promise that all of the juice as a runner is still there, but in the open field, he's a really good receiver still.
Yeah, I did a little tiny little film study on him in the offseason, and exactly what I saw was between the tackles, looked a little slow, but yeah, can definitely catch some balls out of the backfield. So
right, and what I'll say about that is, like, it's tempting with a lot of these guys to say, well, the offensive line was bad or whatever, but here we have the moment when Kenyon Drake comes in, and whatever you want to say about Kenyon Drake, we both would agree he looked like he had more juice than David Johnson as a runner.
Absolutely, but not more juice than our next guy who runs like a bullet out of a cannon, Mr. Phillip Lindsay, who's, you know, looking at a different situation going into 2020.
Sure, and I was just looking, like, I have Lindsay at RB 40, and given that I'm talking about the five players I watch the most on film who are sort of controversial about what you're going to do with them, it's weird to be talking about the RB 40, but of course it's because Melvin Gordon is now in Denver. So I think what I really wanted to see, first of all, it's like, it's exactly what you said, Dave. He's such a fun runner. He's a little tiny, tiny little guy, but he's a between the tackles. He's a behemoth. He's hard to tackle. If a defensive tackle squares him up, he's going to just fall down. Of course, he's little. But any glancing blow, it seems like he just ricochets off. He's like a cartoon character. Such a fun player. I think he potentially has stand. If Denver's offense is way better than we expect, if Drew Lock is just ready to be a lot better than he was at the end of last year, than he's ever been or whatever, we could get two usable running backs out of that offense. It's possible because Lindsay is such a fun player. Here's what I also wanted to see was, why are the Denver Broncos of 2019 using Royce Freeman as their third down back, as their little dump off back? Like, I guess I can't really see a team meeting in film and see why maybe Royce Freeman is more liable as a blocker. I don't know. I can't tell because Lindsay wasn't even out there on a lot of third downs. The best case scenario, we know Melvin Gordon can catch the ball. The best case scenario would be Phillip Lindsay as the third down back, as the change of pace, as the satellite, get him in space, turn him into Tariq Cohen, like, but better because he can actually also take a draw and run for 30 yards, which Cohen's probably never going to do. I just don't know why that hasn't happened yet. The best case for taking Lindsay in the middle rounds would be him turning into a 50 catch player in addition to, say, 120 carry player. At 170 touches, he's going to wind up being a usable flex.
Yeah, especially if he can stay healthy the whole year. I know in the past, you know, he's kind of a smaller guy, but hopefully he'll be able to stand.
Well, I have news for you. He's still a smaller guy in the present.
That's true. Well, not a terribly small guy, but moving to our next guy, also seeing a bit of a different situation, is Mr. Chris Godwin. So
yeah. So I whiffed on Godwin last year. I did a show on the YouTube channel last year saying that I thought Godwin would be a bust, and I talked about why. And some of it was about what I thought he was as a player, which probably in and of itself was a little bit inaccurate. And then some was just about worried about Jameis Winston and worried, like, I never saw coming the Jameis show of not caring that he throws 100 interceptions, right? So whiff, terrible call on Godwin. He's close to the player maybe I watched the most film on, Godwin. How did he do it? You know, like, he's mostly a slot player, or at least he was last year. And slot players, you don't typically see massive yards after the catch because there's tons of people in the middle of the field. And Godwin is just one of these wreckers who, listen, it's not all just Jarvis Landry work. It's not all just, I don't know, Julian Edelman work. There's some downfield stuff, but most of his big plays came on relatively intermediate or short passes. And then him in the open field wrecking people. And athletically speaking, there's a reason to suspect that that is sustainable, even if Jameis isn't going to be there being dumb with the ball. Like, you're now moving to Tom Brady. You're now moving to the most efficient quarterback maybe in the history of the league. It's hard for me to say that what I saw on film from Godwin is just like what you'd see from Julian Edelman. No worries. Brady loves to use slot receivers. We're all good. Like, that's not exactly Godwin's game. He's not the most precise. He's not the least precise, but he's not Edelman. Doesn't have a decade of chemistry with Brady. He doesn't know exactly when to bend his shoulder. He doesn't exactly know how to be open without being open. I think they'll work it out to the point where I think Godwin can still make a lot of big plays after the catch. Maybe not quite as many. Maybe the week-to-week ride for Godwin will wind up being smoother and less scary. Like, why is it the fourth quarter and he only has two catches? Oh, phew, Jameis saved him with a long one. Maybe the peaks will be a little lower as well. But I think overall the message with Godwin was, what I whiffed on was how great he was after the catch.
Well, at least you can admit when you've whiffed on something. But I was.
Well, thanks, Dave.
No, I mean not that you don't normally, but I'm just saying it's nice to see that, especially when.
Here's the one time Harris admits he was wrong.
out of all the fantasy analysts, I can say for sure you admit when you're wrong the most out of anyone. But moving into.
I had a lot of practice.
Yeah. Fair enough. But moving into the next player, the player that I was most surprised to see on the list, that surprised to see you watch so much film on this guy, was Tyler Higbee. I couldn't believe you had poured into so much film.
Yeah, I mean, so he came out of nowhere, right? The reason tight end is such a lousy position for fantasy, and it gets so stinky so fast. We could find 7, 8 guys maybe who you feel okay about, and you don't even feel that okay about the middle, like the 6 through 8. Like, who feels great about Evan Engram? Like, I don't feel great about him. We're looking for people to be reliable for fantasy, and Tyler Higbee won leagues last year. He went crazy when Gerald Everett got hurt. Suddenly it was all Higbee, and he was the best tight end in fantasy from, I don't even know what the number is, but week 13 on, something like that. Crazy. So, statistically, he killed people. So what I wanted to see was he actually out there looking like a freak tight end? And my verdict is very much not. He might be, certainly among tight ends, I can say with certainty that from the ranks that I initially put out on harrisfootball.com in May, I guess after the draft, no one dropped more in those tight end ranks than Higbee after I watched film. And it's because I don't know what that Ram offense is. It turned into such a non-Ram looking offense. I mean, Cooper Kupp didn't play that much in December. Cooper Kupp is, a wide receiver too. He was a flag player last year. He was having a great year, and they kind of just flushed him, even with no Gerald Everett, because they changed the kind of offense that they were, and they turned into a check down machine. And on film, I just don't see Higbee making a ton of amazing downfield plays. Another one where, it's just like sort of volume and checkdowns, and the defense isn't paying attention to me because my name's Tyler Higbee. And I go, maybe the Rams have changed the way they look at him now and are going to use him as a primary receiving weapon. But it felt like the last bastion of a team with a dysfunctional offense and a dysfunctional offensive line. And therefore, I don't think it's who the Rams want to be on offense. And I frankly think Gerald Everett, I don't know. I would draft Higbee before Everett, but I think Everett, he played a hell of a lot more before he got hurt. I don't know. I'm after watching this film and not seeing a ton of super special qualities, I think I'm out on Higbee.
Well, I'm glad to hear that, because I wouldn't want to waste one of my earlier picks or later on picks on a tight end who is just going to come to absolutely nothing.
But, well, earlier, we're not asking you to take an earlier pick regardless. We don't want you taking early tight ends. Later, let's not take Higbee, I think.
Thanks so much for watching. Please, please, please smash that like button. Write a comment, tell us who else you'd like to see us review film on, and of course, best of all, please subscribe to our channel and then click that little bell above the subscribe button, and you'll be notified whenever we post a new video.